Well, I think it is very important to understand that actually the European Union is like a kind of a, you might call it a kind of project, in the sense that it has no precedence in the world. I mean, there's no model that the European Union is following. It's a one-of-a-kind project in the world that you need to well, actually, it's important to see that it started after the Second World War. I think that the experience in Europe of two devastating wars was actually the beginning of thinking about how to overcome these kind of problems. And as soon as the Second World War ended in 1945, people started to think, politicians started to think, what's next? I mean, how are we going to not only to rebuild the continent, but how are we going to make this continent a peaceful continent? And the basic idea actually was that rather than fighting for hegemony in on the European continent, let's work together in such a way that if we entangle the economies of the most important countries at that time, namely Germany and France, if we entangle the economies in such a way that having another war would be very counterproductive, then maybe we can solve this problem. So in a nutshell, this is the starting idea, how to make the European continent, how to transform it into a peaceful continent so that a war, as it has experienced it twice in the 20th century, should not occur again. And it was actually the six countries, so Germany, France, Italy, Belgium, Luxembourg, and the Netherlands, that started to cooperate economically together in such a way that was really the core of what later became what we now see as the European Union. So more and more countries entered the European Economic Zone. So actually, the European project, or the project of the European Union as we know it today, is first and foremost an economic project. But it gradually developed into what we know it today, with a very strong also political body, as it is represented in the European Commission, European Parliament, and etc. So basically, it's a project of nation states working together in order to build a kind of European and political unity in order to have a stand in the world and make Europe peaceful. That is what I would say in a nutshell to your students. Well, I'm old enough to have experienced Europe before the euro was there, before the European Union as we know it today was there. And one of the things that I remember as a child, for example, in Belgium is a very small country, so as soon as you travel 200 kilometers, you're in another country. So we had to cross borders very regularly. And what I remember from childhood is that it was really very, it was an adventure to travel. I mean, you had the experience of really traveling because you were confronted with these borders with France, where you had to, identity papers had to be checked. You had different currencies. In France, you had the franc. In Germany, you had the mark. In the Netherlands, you had the gulden. So you saw a lot of differences in daily life, so to speak, which now with the Schengen zone, with the euro, all these borders are gone, so you can easily travel thousands of kilometers to the south of Spain without even crossing one border or having the experience of crossing one border. So I think that's one of the major changes that I experienced in my own life when I look back. Also, I mean, when you went to the Netherlands, you always had to think about currency. Oh, I have to change Belgian francs into Dutch guldens. So you had to go to the bank. So, I mean, traveling was like something you had to really plan in advance. While now, I mean, you simply jump into the car and drive 200 kilometers, you're in a different country, but it's the same currency. You are free to go wherever you want without having this burdensome trouble of passing borders, things like that. So that's a major change in daily life, I would say. Another thing is that, but that has more to do with the fact that I live in Belgium and most European institutions have their seat in Brussels. So when you go to Brussels today, compared to, let's say, 10, 15 years ago, Europe has a real visible presence in the capital of Belgium, and it's also the capital of Europe. And you can really see this presence because of the institutions like the European Commission. When you go to Berlaymont Square, there you have this imposing building of the European Commission. You have the Council of Europe. All these things, and they have an impact also on daily life. So you have a lot of restaurants like Italian, Spanish cuisine, which is now very easily to taste in Brussels. So yeah, it had an impact on at least my experience of even my own country. Which, of course, if you would live in France and in Paris, would not have that kind of an impact. But speaking from Belgium, these are the kind of things that I would say made a difference. Another very important change, I think, was in the field of education. So at the time of the late 1980s, the Erasmus program started up, and so that was the start of the student mobility. And that plays a tremendous important role, I think, in the experience of students throughout Europe today. I mean, when you do higher education, at least 3 to 6 months, students try to spend 3 to 6 months in another country, studying, of course, in their domain at another university, and have this experience of Europe, so to say. And as a personal note, you can say that one of the first programs that was developed in the Erasmus program was a program on comparative knowledge systems, which was developed with a couple of countries, but started at Ghent University, and that's where I met Balu and came into contact with his research program. So in a sense, you can say that I'm also a product of what Europe had to offer in that regard. Let's begin with the first aspect of your question. It's true that the European Union started as an economic and political project. It is still that. But you had many, during the development of the European Union, or what today is the European Union, you had many treaties that allowed the European Union not only to expand geographically, but also deepening, you could say intellectually or culturally. And I think that the unification of the education with the Bologna treatment, where the different educational systems throughout the European Union were more or less put on the same and the same level that it became easier for people to travel and to study abroad, for example. But also, culture in a sense became also more and more important. And I'll give maybe a concrete example, especially since the Maastricht Treaty, it became possible, because you have to understand that the European Union can only have its, or the basis upon which the European Union can act is if the states transfer certain kinds of authority to the European Union. That's the basis upon which then the European Union can act. Culture is a specific thing because culture is still something that is the domain of the states, and then depending on, like for example, Belgium, cultural issues are on the level of the regions, because Belgium has, is a country where you have two communities, one Dutch speaking in the north, French speaking in the south. So everything that is related to education, culture is now under the authority of the regional government. But still, the European Union can take initiatives to give, impetuses to try to stimulate things. And one of the initiatives, very concretely, for example, is the initiative of the cultural capital of the European Union. So each year throughout the European Union, a place is selected as a cultural capital of Europe. So where many different cultural activities take place, and where not only the country or the place itself where it is happening, like now it is Malta, for example. But I mean, they attract a lot of people and initiative in a wide area of culture, from film, movie, dance, you name it. Is an example on how the European Union is not only a political project, but tries to also deepen its cultural unity, so to speak, despite its diversity. Another example very recently is the initiative of the European Commission and European Parliament in collaboration with the Council of Europe, which is bigger than the European Union, which is called the European Heritage Label, for example. And the idea there is to award a label to sites or monuments or other places that have a significance in the past, which played an important role in the history of Europe, is important to understand where Europe comes from, and that also has a message for the future of Europe. So these labels are awarded for their, not only for the site itself, so it's not something like UNESCO World Heritage Label, for example, which is something different, but also tries to award initiatives for programs for youth to help to understand the history of Europe and its diversity. So yeah, it is a political project to begin with. I mean, when we read in the newspaper about the European Union, it's mostly about the budget of the countries and the European Commission that checks the budgets and things like that. But it's more than that. So it's also it has a cultural component. And what you also begin to see very recently in the last, let's say, 5 years, is that the European Union also sees itself as a cultural force in the world, and they more and more consciously try to use that, in a sense, to give Europe a place in the world among other big regions and cultures like Asia, China, India, the Americas, Africa. So yeah, that's something that you can see as developing more and more in the last couple of years. Based on my experience, I think there is a lot to learn from each other. It's not immediately clear to me on what level this learning should take place or what the implementation of these things could be. But one of the things that is really striking compared to Europe, when you look at India, especially India, is the kind of diversity that you see in this country. A diversity that is also part of its history. I mean, you have so many groups living together. And when you compare the struggles that Europe has with coming to terms with Islam, for example, as something that is really experienced as foreign. And when you look at the way that Islamic community is part of Indian society, that I think is something very important to learn. I mean, what is it that India allows to live together with so many different groups of people without creating violence? Because when you look at Europe, it often transforms into some kind of violence, hatred. When you look at the, especially these days, the right-wing parties that are very popular in Europe. I mean, they thrive on something that has to do with this diversity. So at a very high level, I would say that if Europe has to learn something from India, it definitely has to learn to how to go about with this diversity. But of course, saying this and then, I mean, having insight into or gaining insight into what it actually is, what are these heuristics that people use to live together in such a way, is of course part of what we have to research and gain insight into. But definitely that is something that I would see as a very important point. The more I travel in India and stay in India or Asia at large, is I also begin to see the how little that we know about each other, despite the fact that Europe is present in India for many centuries now, including its colonization. So despite the fact that we have had such a deep relationship, it's striking how little we know about each other. And what we know about each other is most of the time not helpful or simply wrong. So it's not so easy. So I think that we should really reflect on this long period of interaction, both from a European and an Indian perspective, in trying to come to terms with what did we see, what did we think about each other, what kind of image do we have, what kind of knowledge do we think we have about each other. And to be honest, I think that at this moment there is very, very little knowledge that we have. And I mean not only Europe about India, but also India about Europe. It's really striking how little Indians know about Europe, let alone the European Union. I mean, this is completely absent. They know some countries like Germany, France, and have some notion, of course, the UK. But even at that level, the knowledge in India about Europe is very, very shallow. So there is a lot of work also there. Because I also have traveled in China, for example, and when I would compare the situation in China and India, then I think that the future of this cooperation between especially Europe and Asia has to go through India, because of this long history that we share. So basically what we should do is look back at that history from a common perspective, from an Indian perspective, from a European perspective, and really try to understand what did we do, how did India react, and what can we learn from that for the future. So I think it's too early to say at this moment what can India learn from the EU. I mean, there are many things to learn, of course. I mean, India is also a big country with many states. Maybe it could look at the way that the nation states in Europe transferred power to the European Union. Like, for example, one very important aspect is the negotiations about treaties in terms of commerce, in terms of how do you call that? I mean, not when we when the European Union enters into an agreement with other countries, then it's for the whole European Union. So these bilateral agreements on trade and commerce is now on the level of the European Union. So the nation states have given that authority to the European Union, and that functions very well and is now very acute because of the Brexit, of course, because the UK is pulling out of the EU, creating a lot of problems in that regard. So yeah, I mean, the way that this history, this long history of the European Union, how it came about in making laws that were that are applicable throughout the European Union, how it transforms these laws into national law, all these things. Maybe that's a model that definitely can function as an inspiration. But yeah, that's something to think about. And it's not straightforward, I think. Like, but there is definitely a lot to learn. I mean, because despite the problems, especially now with Brexit, which makes it very, very acute, also the it's a little bit strange to say, but because of Brexit, now you begin to see what Europe has done, because it was predicted that the European Union would fall apart and things like that, but actually you begin to see the opposite, so that 27 states are really like acting like one unity, and for good reasons. So even that is something to look into and see what can be learned from that, and see how you in a very peaceful way, you can actually work together with different countries and accomplish something good.